Welcome back to Piemonte. This episode, we're exploring a majestic UNESCO World Heritage Site, retracing the steps of Italian royalty. Andiamo! La Venaria Reale is a masterpiece of Piemonte's cultural heritage. In this video, we'll embark on a journey through the rich history and breathtaking beauty of this magnificent royal palace around 10 kilometers outside of Torino. The Venaria Reale history begins around the mid-17th century, from 1658 onwards, which is when Duke Carlo Emanuele II and Duchess Maria Giovanna Battista commissioned the construction of this stunning estate, which would serve as one of their many stately houses. Court architect Amedeo di Castellamonte was appointed to design the estate, which would include a palace, a park, as well as a hunting ground and village. It would also include many fountains, staircases, and multi-level terraces. The Hall of Diana lies at the heart of the palace, where visitors once arrived after crossing the entrance yard and the Court of Honor. With its magnificent frescoes depicting scenes from the life of Diana, the Roman goddess of hunting. This beautiful gallery connected the apartments of the king to that of the crown prince, and is one of the most spectacular spaces of the entire complex. Its magnificent decorations are the work of Pietro Filippo Sommaso, Giuseppe Bollina, Antonio Papa, and Giovan Battista San Bartolomeo. The size of the gallery is also remarkable, 15 meters in height at the center of the vault, 80 meters in length, and 12 in width. One of the peculiarities of the Great Gallery lies in the splendid light effects created by the 44 windows and 22 eyelets on the ceiling. The resulting lights and shadows further enhance the rich decorations, and the two elaborate chambers at the ends never fail to inspire awe in all its visitors. A little tip, if you're wanting to enjoy this space all to yourself, definitely get a ticket and arrive for opening, and be sure to make your way through to this room to capture any images or videos you want to before it gets busy with all the tourists later on. Dreaming of your next vacation? As an experienced travel professional, I would be happy to help you plan a tailor-made itinerary. Visit me online at somethingaboutdavid.com for any inquiries. Starting in 1699, the architect Michelangelo Garrove redesigned the whole complex of the palace into an even more imposing and magnificent estate, matching the ambitions of Vittorio Amedeo II. The gardens were redesigned in the French style of architecture by taking inspiration from the famous gardens of Versailles. It's also when the Duke became the king, and then in 1716, he commissioned for the expansion of the estate to Filippo Giuvara. In 1739, Carlo Emanuele III instructed Benedetto Alfieri to connect the various sections of the estate through a system of galleries and spaces, including new stables and a covered riding ground. The estate would then remain the home of the king until the decline of the ancient regime. Between 1798 and 1999, the palace served as the military barracks, which happened after the arrival of Napoleon. The king fled from the estate, and the original layout of the gardens were completely destroyed to be transformed into a military drill ground. The fountains, sculptures, and flower beds were replaced by muskets, cannons, guns, and horses. The park bustled with uniformed troops in the Wars of Independence, and then later with Italian soldiers during World War I and II. After the departure of the military, vandals stripped it bare, taking away all reusable parts, including door frames and window panes, destroying whatever was left of the palace. Benedetto Alfieri added the Rondo Gallery with its elegant statues representing the four seasons, acting as a hub in the grandiose ceremonial route of the palace. The Cappella di Sant'Uberto is dedicated to the patron saint of hunters, and it served as a place of worship for the royal family and their guests. The chapel is known for its exquisite interior decoration, including frescoes and ornate furnishings. The numerous sumptuous decorations enrich the clever contrasts of light inside, making the environment truly unique. The true star of the chapel is the main altar, the work of Giovanni Baratta, which appears suspended, almost framed by the beam of light that provides the backdrop to the tabernacle supported by marble angels. The altar develops vertically, placing itself between the two central columns of the basin created by the apse. The light, which enters abundantly from the high windows behind, highlights the jagged shape of the altar and multiplies its tones and colors. The House of Savoy was one of the oldest royal families in Europe and ruled various territories, including the Kingdom of Sardinia and later the unified Kingdom of Italy. They were known for their opulent lifestyle, and ceremonial carriages were often used for official events and occasions. The term bucintoro is well known to Venetians, who so-called the gondolas of the doges, but not everyone knows that the Savoys also had one themselves here for the royal palace of Venaria. Unlike the Venetian boats, which had a practical navigation function, the Savoy one was purely for river parades. The term berlina dorata translates to golden carriage, indicating a carriage adorned with gold or gold-colored embellishments. These carriages were typically used for royal processions, weddings, coronations, and other grand events. Il bucintoro and carriages are integral and representative masterpieces of the activities of the royal scuderia at court, responsible for the movements of the sovereign and their escorts. It's an unmissable permanent exhibition, both for better understanding the history of the palace, its territory, and the dynasty that governed it, but also of an era that together they represent. Surrounding the palace are expansive gardens, featuring manicured lawns, intricate mazes, and sculptures offering a serene retreat from the hustle and bustle of city life. The restoration of the estate and its gardens began in the late 20th and early 21st centuries. The project was commissioned by the Ministry for Cultural Heritage, with the support of the European Union and the Ministry for Economy. Frescoes, decorations, and archaeological findings were brought back to light by using cutting-edge restoration techniques. This was the largest project for the restoration of a cultural asset ever undertaken in the European continent that revived a surface of 100,000 square meters. The project recovered over 9,500 square meters of stucco work and 1,000 square meters of frescoes, in addition to completely revamping the 50 hectares of gardens. The rebirth of this estate took place in the year 2007, when the palace and its gardens were inaugurated and made open for the public. Numerous permanent displays, exhibitions, concerts, and art performances, and even entertainment events were organized here for the people to take a glimpse into what this magnificent estate once used to look like. A cinema by Peter Greenaway and sculptures by Giuseppe Pinone were also added during this time. In recognition of its outstanding universal value, La Venaria Reale was designated as a UNESCO World Heritage Site in 1997, ensuring its preservation for future generations to enjoy. But how do you get to the palace? Well, Trenitalia offers a train from Torino Porto Susa direct to the village next to the palace hourly. Alternatively, there are buses from Torino that go the direction of the palace, as well as a service called the Venaria Express, which I personally took from Piazza Vittorio Veneto, making it the most simple round-trip journey from the palace and Torino. I hope you enjoyed this tour of the fantastic and majestic palace within Piemonte. Until next time, alla prossima! Did you enjoy this episode? please hit the like button and subscribe to be in the know for future episodes.